Good morning. And welcome to Lutheran Church of the Lakes. What a wonderful way for us to begin our week, to gather here in our Lord's house, to sing his praises, be fed by his word and sacrament, and to encourage one another in the wonderful commission that God has given us, his church, to go forth and proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. And, as is fitting, since just over a month ago, I wished all moms a blessed Mother's Day. Today, I want to wish all the dads a blessed Father's Day. What a wonderful estate our good Lord has created, and what a wonderful job that God has given fathers in our world. Will you please rise? We make our beginning this morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, to call upon him in prayer and praise, and to receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot save ourselves from our sinful condition. Together, as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. We confess together. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins, as a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority. I therefore forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
Our intro at this morning is taken from Psalm 67. Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy. For you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth fear him. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Let the peoples praise you, O God.
Let all the peoples praise you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
In the word of your apostles and prophets, you have proclaimed to us your saving will. Grant us faith to believe your promises, that we may receive eternal salvation. through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading is from the book of Exodus, the 19th chapter. The people of Israel set out from Rephidim and came into the wilderness of Sinai, and they encamped in the wilderness. There Israel encamped before the mountain while Moses went up to talk to God. The Lord called to him out of the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the people of Israel, you yourselves have seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." So Moses came and called the elders of the people and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. All the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken, we will do." And Moses reported the words of the people to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The second reading is from the book of Romans, the 5th chapter. "For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned, for sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. But the free gift is not like the trespass. For if many died through one man's trespass, much more have the grace of God, and the free gift by that grace, that one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many." This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
This is a song that Pastor Kurt requested for Father's Day, and if I do the song justice, I think you'll see why. The song is called "Be Like You." Happy Father's Day.
Really gone this fast, holding my baby girl in my hands. 10 million thoughts running through my mind, and one thing's for sure, God, I wanna get this right. I wanna love her like you love me, give her everything I can. I wanna live a life that's holy and be a better man. You could have chosen anybody, and I'm the one you gave her to. She's gonna be like me, and God, I wanna be like you. Finally turned 5 and he looks like me. Always playing baseball or climbing up some tree. gotta know he won't always be this young. Let him grow up proud to be his daddy's son. I wanna love him like you love me, give him everything I can. I wanna live a life that's holy, be a better man. You could have chosen anybody, but I'm the one you gave him to. If he's gonna be like me, 'cause their feet are gonna follow where their father leads them to. So Father, won't you lead me straight to you, to you. And when my life is over, I pray they will look back and say they saw a bit of Jesus in their dad. I wanna love them like you love me, give them everything I can. I wanna live a life that's holy and be a better man. You could have chosen anybody, and I'm the one you gave them to. If they're gonna be like me, oh, if they're gonna be like me, then God, I wanna be like you.
That song makes me cry, even when Dave sings it. Will you please rise? Our gospel reading this morning is from Matthew, the 9th and 10th chapters. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction. And he called to him his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits, to cast them out and to heal every disease and every affliction. The names of the 12 apostles are these. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother. James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother. Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Zealot, and Judas Iscariot, who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, instructing them, "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and proclaim as you go, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. You received without paying, give without pay." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Heavenly Father, for the sake of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. 2 weeks in a row, you have listened to me talk about change, right? And that always makes people nervous. Always makes people nervous. Change is generally something that we dread. And yet sometimes when we find ourselves in a difficult situation, what do we reach out and ask God to do? We ask God to change the circumstances. Change can be frightening because so often it's not in our control. It's not. Maybe that's what scares us. Maybe we like to live in this illusion that as long as we can control things, we will be okay. But that is truly what? A lie. Gang, is God ever surprised by anything? Is God surprised by any of the changes? The answer is no. He's not. Because who is ultimately in control? God is, right? God is in control. In fact, if I had to put it to you this way, who do you prefer to be in control of your life, you or God? You would say what? God. Of course you would. But what's the irony of that? You really behave like you could do a better job of it. And we're all guilty. We do it. We readily say, God, be in control. And then we grump when he does what? When he brings change. Someone pointed out to me recently some of the changes that have gone on. You look back at the history of this congregation, and you could say, wow, there have been some changes that, well, didn't have very positive results. And I get it. I do. I get it. In my first circuit, when I got to my first call, we would meet with a bunch of every month with all my brother pastors, and I was the newbie, fresh out of seminary, and there was just kind of a veteran old pastor. He had been a teacher for 25 years, then went into seminary, became a pastor, and now had been a pastor for about another 20 years. He was close to retirement when I met him. Had a wonderful congregation. He retired. They called a new guy. He was young, and he was handsome, and he was dynamic, and he changed everything within that congregation rapidly. And it never recovered. The congregation is now gone. Closed its doors. Within 20 years, it's gone. That is anecdotal evidence that sometimes change can have less than desirable outcomes. I met another guy, young pastor, not nearly as handsome as the first one. Went to this congregation that was in the middle of cornfields. Made this place look like a metropolis. And he made changes. And that congregation grew It was very different from what they had been doing. And my point in sharing those two stories is that we have this anecdotal evidence that change can sometimes cause harm, can sometimes cause blessings. But I want to be something very clear, because this is easy to misunderstand, all right? As I've preached to you about change for the past 2 weeks, it's easy, again, to think about corporate change, changes that all of us need to make. But I don't want your mind to go there. Instead, I want your mind to go to the only person that you can change, right? Which is who? Yourself, okay? I'm going to repeat this because this is easy to misunderstand. I'm not advocating talking about some kind of corporate change. I'm talking individual change. Because, again, we are the only ones we can change. You know this. However, you also know that we can be very resistant when God calls us to change. Raise your hand if you're a dad. Phil, right?
Yes.
All right. Phil, how long were you married before you and Susie had children?
Not very long.
Not very long. Okay. I often refer to that time of life as BC, before children. How much did your life change when you had your first child? That's, to be honest, that's hard to quantify, right? Because I'm imagining that every aspect of your life changed. I also want to say, and I'm confident in this, that every aspect of your life became harder. Because raising children is what? Hard, right? On a scale of 1 to 10, it's a 12. It's hard. But would you trade that experience for anything else in the world? Don't think too long, Phil. He's up here contemplating. Well, let me see. And again, I can speak for dads, and I would say, no. God brings this momentous change into your life. And it makes your life infinitely more difficult. But it's worth it. You wouldn't trade it. It's why I tear up when Dave sang so beautifully that song. Because you know it's true, right? That your kids are going to follow. They're going to be led by their dad. And you so desperately don't want to screw that up. But it's change. And it's scary, and it's hard. But was it a surprise to God? And the answer is no. As we go forward in this process of an intentional interim pastorate, I am going to challenge you to look in the mirror and say, how can I change to grow stronger and better in my walk with the Lord? Because it's my working theory that as we change individually, right, that corporate change will merely follow along. We'll drag it along in the wake of our personal change. The gospel reading was the calling of the 12 apostles, right? Someone tell me the defining moment in the lives of the apostles where you can visibly see a radical change in their demeanor. What was it? The resurrection. Absolutely. It was the resurrection. You look at that one moment, the greatest moment in history, where Jesus Christ rose from the grave. And that moment changed his apostles. And that change is actually one of the greatest arguments that we have for the validity of the resurrection. The accusation, of course, by unbelievers is what? That this is all a fairy tale, that it's all simply made up, right? That Jesus wasn't really dead. The apostles just took down his body. They hid him for a few days. And when he got better, they're like, oh, hey, look, he rose from the dead. They wanted it to be a hoax. But guys, what evidence do we have that strongly says, no, the resurrection was real and not a hoax? They did never find the body, but also you have the perpetrators of the would-be hoax, right? The 12 apostles. And yet, how did these 12 men, well, 11, we know how Judas died. How did the 11 remaining apostles and Matthias, who replaced Judas, how did they die? So, 11 of them were martyred, right? We know that John, who wrote the Gospel of John and then 1st, 2nd, 3rd John and the book of Revelation, John died of natural causes, of old age. But the other 11 were all martyred, some of them gruesomely. And did any one of them ever recant? Did any one of them ever say, oh, guess what, guys? This was just a hoax. Don't get too carried away here. You see, people will lie in order to enrich themselves, right? They will. But will people knowingly die? I'm sorry, let me rephrase that. Will someone die for something that they know is a lie? Will someone die for something they know is a lie? And the answer is no, they won't. Especially if that death is what? Prolonged. Gruesome. James, the brother of John, was the first apostle to die. He was beheaded by Herod Agrippa. We know that from Scripture. But not before he went all the way out to Spain to preach and proclaim the gospel. Peter, how did he die? He was crucified upside down. What's the importance of that? How do you die in crucifixion? You suffocate. You get so weak by hanging there that you actually, your head, you can't hold your head up, and you cut off your own airway. That's why the Roman soldiers went and broke the legs of the criminals on Good Friday. Because with their legs broken, they couldn't hold themselves up. They would asphyxiate quicker. And they didn't break Jesus' legs because he was already dead, because he had been tortured near to death before he was even crucified. But when you're crucified upside down, what don't you do? Asphyxiate, which means your death takes what? A heck of a lot longer. Days, nailed to a cross, hanging upside down. Peter's brother, Andrew, also crucified. What kind of cross was Andrew crucified on? It was in the shape of an X, right? Anyone here of Scottish descent? Because the national flag of Scotland is what? The cross of St. Andrew. Again, also upside down. Death would take days. Thomas. Doubting Thomas. How did Doubting Thomas die? He was in India proclaiming the gospel. And the message so upset the local king that he had Thomas pitched off a cliff. But that didn't kill him. So then he ran him through with a spear. But that didn't kill him. Then they just had to stone him. That killed him. Bartholomew. Don't hear a lot about old Bartholomew. How'd old Bartholomew got? How did he die? How was he martyred? He was flayed alive. What does that mean? Skinned alive. Guys, can you imagine a much more gruesome death than that? And yet, every one of those apostles did what while they were being executed, while they were being martyred? What did they do? They preached. They continued to preach. Do you do that when you know something is a lie? And the answer is no, you don't. So why share the horror stories? Why share the gruesome deaths of these 12 men, 11 guys? Because I want you to notice the power of change. Because as you read through the Gospels and you read the apostles who were bickering, right, sometimes with one another, that Jesus would admonish with saying what? Oh, you of little faith. As you witness one blunder and one goof and one screw up after the next with these 12 guys. And yet after the resurrection, there was such a radical change in them that their lives become a witness, become a powerful testimony to the most remarkable event in human history, the Son of God rising from the dead. Because these 12 guys believed it with their whole heart. They were willing to die for this. And the change in them, let me repeat that, the change in them was remarkable. And that's the change that I want you to focus on. Because just like having a child changes your life forever, having a relationship with Jesus Christ, becoming God's child, changes your life forever. None of us here know what tomorrow is going to bring, what changes God has in store for us. And I've made this point before. God doesn't consult us when it comes to these changes that he has in store. But he promises us that he is faithful, that he will be there. He promises us that he has already defeated the greatest enemy, sin and death, by the resurrection of Christ's Son. We know that our salvation is secured, that our eternity in heaven has already been gifted to us. He promises us that we are his beloved possession. He has suffered condemnation on our behalf. He took our place in hell and gave to us his place in heaven. And that's what strengthens us for whatever change God has in store. So my challenge remains. It's what God calls us to, right? To look in the mirror of his law and say, where can I grow? How can God change me to become more like his Son? And then have the willingness of spirit to trust God as he leads us through that change. In Jesus' name, amen.